Welcome to FilmmakerIQ.com. Join me as we track the history of video and trace the journey to our modern concept of film and video editing. Since the earliest filmmakers, there has always been a need for editing, cutting out the boring bits and keeping the good stuff. With good old-fashioned celluloid film, cutting apart and splicing pieces of film together is a rather intuitive process. Editing machines like the Moviola have been around since the 1930s, with the Steenbeck flatbed editor becoming popular in the 70s and still used to this day. So how do we move to a digital form of editing, a computer-based non-linear editing that dominates the industry today? Well, to answer that question, we need to dial back the clock of history and look at the early days of the industry that was the impetus for computerized editing. Television. Our story begins in the era of electronic and mechanical engineers. Now, technologically speaking, the capability of broadcasting live TV signals started rather early in the 20th century. In fact, November 2nd, 1936 was when the BBC began transmitting the world's first public regular broadcast service. But it had to go off the air during World War II. That war required world economies to switch gears and produce military supplies, preventing the mass production and adoption of television. And it wasn't until 1948, 3 years after the war had ended, that the first commercial broadcast of television began in the United States. And the medium caught on immediately and exploded during the 50s. People could now watch shows and news broadcasts right in their own home. These shows were cut live in a studio that had several cameras hooked up to a video switcher that could switch between the different camera angles. The signal was then sent through cables to affiliates in other parts of the TV network for broadcast. The problem was everything had to be done live, as there was no way to electronically record the television signal. That's fine, unless you wanted to delay the broadcast, say for a faraway part of the country that was in a different time zone. So, in order to record television, the networks turned to a device called a kinescope, which is quite simply a film camera focused in on a video monitor. The concept is really simple, it's laughably simple, but it was anything but. The process never did result in really good image reproduction. There was lots of technological hurdles like ghosting and banding, but kinescopes were the essential tool that started connecting the world together through the medium of television. Here's an example. In 1951, once CBS and NBC had a coast-to-coast network, they would produce a show in New York at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Kinescopes in Los Angeles, which were 3 hours ahead of them, would record the signal through the network. The film was then rushed immediately into development and then shown less than 3 hours later at 8 p.m. West Coast Pacific Time, a process called hot kinescope, because the film didn't even have a chance to cool from the development process before it was being sent to air. I mean, the demand for television was so great that by 1954, the TV networks were actually using more raw film stock in their kinescopes than all of Hollywood film studios combined, spending up to $4,000 per half hour. That's $33,000 in today's money. The networks were desperate for a cheaper alternative. Magnetic tape had been used for audio recording for years, but there were still some significant technological hurdles to actually getting video images onto a tape. In 1951, engineers working for Bing Crosby's production company, were the first to record video images onto magnetic tape. Unfortunately, it looked terrible, but it was still an image, and it proved that it could be done. In 1956, after 5 years of hard work by brilliant engineers overcoming a myriad of hurdles, Ampex would release the first commercially available video tape recorder, the 2-inch quadruplex video tape. Sales of the first video tape recorder went through the roof when the company showcased it at NAB convention in April of 1956. Sales were so strong that they had to take orders on napkins. Now, CBS was the first to put it to use in a West Coast delay broadcast of Douglas Edwards and the News on November 30th, 1956. On January 22nd, 1957, The NBC game show Truth or Consequences, produced in Hollywood, became the first television program to be broadcast in all time zones from a pre-recorded tape. Now, by 1959, just a couple years after the introduction, videotape was almost fully accepted by the television industry, and tape played a very interesting role in a small Cold War confrontation. That summer, the U.S. Information Agency set up an exhibit in Moscow to show off American progress and technology to the Russians. This included a model American home with a fully decked-out kitchen, a model TV studio with its own Ampex video recorder. And on July 24, 1959, then-Vice President Richard Nixon invited Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev to visit this display. Khrushchev was fascinated by the television studio, and he joined Nixon in what was essentially a photo op in front of the cameras and the new videotape technology. The two began chatting, but before long it turned into a full-blown debate on the merits of capitalism and communism. Both leaders agreed that their exchange, their debate, should be played in full in their own respective countries. And Ampex International President Philip Gundy then took the tape of them arguing and wrapped it in a dirty shirt for his flight back home to the United States. Before he got home, though, American newspapers had reported that the exchange between the two was so icy that it practically started World War III. But when the American TV networks played it the very next day, what viewers saw were actually two leaders just acting like politicians.
Here you can see the type of tape which will transmit this very conversation immediately, and this indicates the possibilities of increasing communication, and this increase in communication will teach us some things, and it will teach you some things too, because after all, you don't know everything.
Если я ничего не все знаю, так вы о коммунизме совсем ничего не знаете. Кроме страха у вас ничего нет. Поэтому я хочу, чтобы вы, вице-президент, что вы даете слово, что моя речь тоже будет записана на английском языке. Будет, нет?
Certainly it will. Certainly. Yes. Right. And by the same token, everything that I say will be recorded and translated and will be carried all over the Soviet Union. That's a fair bargain.
This kitchen debate, as it came to be known, was a milestone in videotape, proving the importance of the medium to world events. At this point, tape was only being used for archival and distribution purposes. It was possible to edit these early 2-inch quadruplex tapes. It was a similar process to cutting film, but extremely more cumbersome. First, the tape had to be developed using extremely fine iron filings suspended in a toxic and carcinogenic carbon tetrachloride solution, making the magnetic bands on the videotape visible when viewed through a microscope so that they could be aligned in a specialized splicer, which had to cut the tape exactly during the vertical retrace signal without disturbing the odd-even field ordering. And since video and audio read heads were several inches apart in the machine, it was not possible to make a physical cut that would function correctly for both video and audio. So the cut was made for video and a portion of the audio then recopied into the correct relationship. And of course, you had to do all of this without actually seeing what frame you were working on, because quadruplex tape was incapable of holding still frames. Now, NBC developed a workaround using tried and true kinescopes, not for broadcast, but for creating work prints. Now, they would edit the shows using the kinescope film prints, using traditional film editing techniques, and this print had audio cues which the editor could then match back to the videotape when they were splicing the videotape, known as ESG. This process is similar to what would later become offline editing, which essentially means editing with a lower quality copy of the original and then assembling the original using that edit. This technique would reach its height with Rowan and Martin's Laugh-In in 1968, which required 350 to 400 tape splices and 60 hours of physical splicing to build up just one episode. Laffin ended up being the only program to actually use this technique extensively.
Sock it to me, sock it to me, sock it to me, sock it to me.
Sock it to yourself.
Sock it to me?
There was another technique of editing video coming into play. Using two video decks, you could transfer video from one deck to the other and build up a show by assembling a bunch of different cuts, one after the other, in a linear fashion. This was linear editing. But again, it sounds simpler than it was. For one, how do you make sure signals between two video decks matched up? Before linear editing became a popular solution, it would require a few technological advancements. The first came in 1963. Ampex introduced the EditTech, an all-electronic video tape recorder that had a simple microprocessor that could control in and out points marked by audible tones. About the same time, you had helical scan systems coming more into use. They wrapped the tape around a spinning reed head in a helical fashion. This meant you could fit more bandwidth on the tape, which allowed you to pause the tape and see individual frames, making editing much easier. And in 1967, the SMPTE timecode, developed by EECO and the Society of Motion Pictures and Television Engineers, was a way for videotape players to locate any frame on a tape, as each frame was assigned an address in terms of hours, minutes, seconds, and frames. These three advancements made timecode-accurate linear editing possible, and the practice became commonplace in the 1970s. So we went from TV networks spending thousands per hour on kinescope film and development fees to now smaller market TV affiliates having their own video editing systems to cut their own shows, all in a matter of about 15 years. But linear editing did not do anything to advance the craft of editing creatively. The editing became almost a strictly technical profession, managing large EDLs, edit decision lists, that mark in and out points of clips to be used. And because a show was assembled in a linear fashion, any changes to the beginning of a show would mean everything after that would have to be reassembled. So there really was no such thing as a rough cut. If you wanted to edit creatively and experiment, well, you still had to use film. There was yet another alternative starting to emerge, almost a rejection of the strict timecode rules of linear editing, going back to the freedom of cutting with actual film, a system that would eventually be called non-linear editing. Non-linear editing was non-destructive. You could assemble a cut in whatever order you wanted and go back and make changes without disturbing the rest of the assembly. There was no generation loss you had with linear editing that required you to copy from tape to tape. It was just a much more natural way of editing. Non-linear editing was computer-based editing, and you needed two things: computational power and fast data storage. The first NLE was the CMX 600 in 1971, and this was a beast of a machine. It recorded half-resolution black and white video files onto these washing machine-sized disc packs. The whole thing cost a little over $250,000, and this is 1971. That's about $1.2 million in 2013 money. Only six were ever produced. But the idea of editing non-linearly, well, that was just too good to let go to waste. Now, through the 80s, it was really a matter of waiting for computational power and storage capability to catch up. You had a few experiments during this time, notably the Edit Droid, which debuted at NAB in 1984, from a George Lucas spin-off company, DroidWorks. This computer pulled footage stored on laser discs, which really didn't work that well, and the whole company shut down in 1987. Other machines tried to use a bank of VCRs, but it was also slow and cumbersome. Then in 1988, EMC2 introduced the first all-digital offline non-linear editor with the data stored on optical discs. This was followed a year later by the public release of the Avid 1, a Macintosh-based non-linear editor in 1989. Avid would go on to become the gold standard for editing in Hollywood.
Let's start with a few fundamentals. I have a bin on this monitor organized as a list. Much easier, though, to see it as images. as head frames. I'm going to edit a sequence together very quickly in assemble edit. Grab the first element, drag it to this window, the record window, and now I've made my first edit. And it shows up on this timeline. Second element, and the third element. In just a few seconds, I've put together the beginnings of a program.
Storage was still an issue, and these machines could only edit short music videos and commercials. But in 1993, engineers added more storage to an Avid system, debuting a 7 terabyte system capable of handling a feature-length film. Now, these films were being cut offline, the reverse of NBC's EGS method. They used low-quality digital files to create a work cut, and then used the time code from that work cut to create an EDL, which was given to the film lab to assemble the original film prints. The first studio film cut on the Avid was Lost in Yonkers in 1993. Just a few short years later, in 1996, editor Walter Murch would go on to accept the Oscar for Best Editing for The English Patient, which he cut offline on an Avid.
Honey, what's happening?
Can't see, sir. It's from the road.
Corporal! Cops, sir! I don't know what it's about.
Stop him! What's happened? Is it armed?
Hang on, sir. I'll be right with you. Can you see the detonator? We've got to cut it so that frost won't last.
Stop! Stop! Slow down! Stop! Stop! Slow down!
Go away!
Making me incredibly angry.
I know, sir. Push out that bed! Can you feel it? Cut it, sir. Cut it!
I don't even know if this is the right wire. Just choose a loop and cut it.
From clumsy kinescope film to bulky magnetic tapes, which finally bring us to the first NLE systems, which proved to be an important creative tool just a few years after its release, the path to modern editing during this period has been dominated by some amazing achievements by electronics engineers. But the story is only half finished. As we enter the last part of the 20th century, computer scientists, programmers, and mathematicians would pioneer a revolution that would join film and television as more or less an interchangeable visual medium, a medium that is accessible to now nearly everyone. It's the story of digital, and we'll pick it up in part 2 as we trace the journey to modern editing.